The street artist Finch is perhaps the most recognizable street artist in San Francisco, with his mega-sized honey bears, pop art lips, poppy flowers, and poodles gracing our city in the unlikeliest of places. He wasn't always pursuing a passion in art, much less an attempt at a career in it, and he rarely speaks publicly about what it's like to be him, although he is known for being the only anonymous TED speaker to date. And this episode goes deep into the below-the-line version of someone that has very little above the line, outside of his public work that, well, by design, is through the medium of street art, so that everyone can enjoy the aesthetic upgrade in and around the city, which is the above-the-line version that people know of Finch. It's not much. But even though that's the intention, to stay out of sight, to make the art the focus, art that is often against the law, and we talk about that very acute fact, and the acute fact that not everyone enjoys it. It's a really fascinating conversation. We chat about how he's taken the risks and intentional, exceptionally hardworking steps, as well as riding lucky waves, to become one of the rare artists to make a living from his art within just a few years of picking up a spray paint can. You can find out more of the above-the-line version online at fnnch.com. That's fnnch.com. And you can hear the other side right now. This is Below the Line.
Hello.
Fnnch.
James.
Cheers.
Cheers.
We are drinking today's weird drink that we are sharing, adventurously sharing together, is Highball Energy Sparkling Energy Water, and is grapefruit flavor. To describe this for listeners, it is it's a tall boy can, and it's white with some cool branding, little speckled dots, and it's called Highball Energy. Have you ever had this before?
I have not.
What is your, when you're creating art, what's your go-to? Do you have a go-to drink?
I'm just going to start weird here. Yeah. I drink mildly salted water.
What?
So I put a little bit of salt in my water. It makes it to pee less, and I think it tastes good. So I have like a water bottle, like a thermos, and I just fill that up before I go into the studio. I don't trust necessarily the water that comes out of the pipes in my studio. So I just bring it from home, from the filter.
Really?
And then, just add a little bit of salt into the bottle before I take it.
When did you start doing that? How did you even know to do that?
I started it, what's the book? The guy who started on it wrote a book.
Aubrey Marcus?
Aubrey Marcus, thank you. And it's called One Great Day or something. Seize the day, kill the day, I don't know.
Yeah.
Anyway, so he talks about right in the morning, he has his quote-unquote morning elixir, which I do. So it's basically like I use mason jars for water. So it's like a full mason jar of water plus some salt plus some lemon juice. And it's just that you're most dehydrated in the morning. And so he has this whole rant about how we jump in the shower and we cover ourselves in water, but we don't actually drink any of it. And so it's just to start the day off right, just start with a glass of water. And so that's when I started salting the water for that. And then I was like, actually, it tastes pretty good. And so I don't put quite as much salt in it as he recommends in the morning for my kind of everyday water.
How much does he recommend? How much do you put in?
I think it's like 30 grams or something. You have to read the book. I don't remember exactly. I put about half of that. Probably, I know it by the number of twists of my salt shaker. So I do like 15 twists instead of 30 twists. I measured it once to calibrate my salt grinding action. And then just assume that it's about the same every time.
And it's just to limit how it does it help with the uptake of the actual hydration?
Yeah, I'd heard about this, I guess, twice, once from him, and then once, I think, sometime on the Tim Ferriss show, where he talked about having to pee a lot. And so, also it kind of tastes good. I don't have a huge philosophy around it. I'm not like some, saltwater evangelist.
No, but I'm super intrigued.
But I think it tastes a little better than normal water. And I just don't like to take as many pee breaks. So I think I've heard that it makes you a little heavier because you just retain the water, but it's just water. So it's not like I'm I'm not that worried. I don't like watch my weight in that way where I'm like, oh my gosh, I have a pound, extra pound of water weight on me. Freaking out.
What are some of the other, and some of the oddest kind of routines that, that you, you'll do during the day?
So I also do the butter coffee thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I do 15 grams of butter and then a scoop of protein powder. And then I actually use instant coffee now, which I'll admit to the world. I went through a whole phase of, you know, reading PhD dissertations on total dissolved solids and optimal extraction curves for coffee. And then eventually just realized that I just don't care that much. I just want to get up, like get my first meal in. So I basically wake up. I don't eat maybe for a couple hours. I just drink the morning elixir and then kind of get some work done. I just want to get up and get to work right away. And then when I actually take a break to have like the first meal, basically is the butter coffee.
What time do you wake up?
7:30, ideally. If I'm up really late in the studio, I'll just sleep later because I just got the work in at night. But I usually try to fall asleep. I go to bed around 10 and then, you know, get a good 8.5 hours and then get up. If I'm getting to bed earlier, I just, whatever, I set the alarm kind of 8-ish hours after I go to bed.
Well, we've been friends for a few years and I know that you have probably consumed as much of the information as anyone I know on this type of stuff, especially with your creative endeavors. So this is really, actually want to keep asking about this. So you wake up at 7:30 and then how much work will you do?
Yeah. So today, I always like to get something productive done first. And so there's, my work is varies a lot depending on sort of what phase I'm in. So right now I'm doing studio work, but it's a very waterfall process. So right now I'm just trying to get the next batch of paintings prepped. So I need to figure out
what are waterfall means.
Oh, it's like you start at, it's a very clear progression of a project. So I now have like a spreadsheet where it's like, okay, I've got 12 commissions coming in. And I'm not going to start those until May 1st. And then on May 1st, I get the design process going for everybody. And so this involves either they know exactly what they want already. So cool. I did one where it's a classic honey bear on a 7-foot-tall, 4-foot-wide canvas. And so there's no real new design work to do except for figuring out how the stencils fit together for that canvas. But then there's some where, you know, somebody wanted a bear with a burrito. And so I have to go and sketch out that burrito and sort of get, you know, or maybe they don't know exactly what they want. They're like, okay, I've chatted with them. We have 3 ideas of where this could go. So I'll do sketches producing those 3 or up to 3, depending. And then I'll show those to them and then they'll select one. And then I'll make the stencil design. And then we can sort of iterate that maybe 1 to 3 times for only size, color, and placement. And so I have the spreadsheet where it's like image design 1, design review 1, image design 2, design review 2.
Right.
Yeah, like design approved. Then it's stencil design, like really figuring out how it's going to look finalized, and then trapping, which is basically making sure the shapes overlap properly so you don't get gaps when you paint, and then like stencil cut design, figuring out how it tiles across sheets of cardboard for the piece, and then buy supplies, you know, cut stencils, prepare to paint, ship, deliver, whatever, right? So it's sort of like everything kind of goes down that progression, and there's a line.
It's not as left brain
yeah, exactly. to
creating art I've ever heard, but
yeah.
But it's I imagine it's phenomenally simplifying for you just to keep track of everything.
Yeah, when I started doing the stencil designs, I didn't really know how I did it. I just kind of did it. I sort of just got into, like, everything starts in Adobe Illustrator, and I basically work from photographs, and I have a Wacom Cintiq, which is a pen display, so I draw on the screen. And so I had just been doing work like this for a long time, and just kind of just did it. But then as I did it more, I was like, oh, I see. Like, the first thing I do is go source a lot of photos. And the next thing I do is kind of do preliminary traces of those photos to see, you know, which one might be the best. And then I select mm-hmm. one. And then I do. And so it's become this really, what I find funny is, like, the more that you zoom in on anything, it's like you keep looking for art somewhere. But as you zoom in, you basically find science down there.
Yeah.
And so when I zoom out, it looks like art. But when I look in, I'm like, a monkey could do any of these steps.
Right.
Right.
And do you mean just when you zoom in, you see an Excel spreadsheet, you see a process.
It's just like, yeah,
you see a stenciled out like, version of something that
I have just like a repeatable process for producing the stencil designs.
Mm-hmm.
And I ask myself the question of, oftentimes for anything in my art, if you were to substitute somebody else for me here, would the product be the same?
Mm-hmm.
And the answer is yes, in only a couple of areas. And so the best I have for like where the quote unquote art actually exists is as I'm actually like looking at the photo and like drawing it and doing my little squiggly lines. Mm-hmm. Like the choice of where to put those squiggles is sort of an intuitive process. And that's where the art is. But I think that another skilled illustrator could copy my style and produce quote unquote Finch work in the same way that I can certainly do anything Banksy pre 2010. Like I could trivially reproduce because I know exactly he's just taking an image, putting in a Photoshop, taking the level slider, sliding it down to the right level, and then just whatever, spraying that onto like printing it on paper, cutting it out with an X-Acto knife, spraying that onto another sheet, cutting around the edges, fill the second one white, fill the first one black. That's his whole process. And then he started figuring out shading, and then now he does crazy brushwork and stuff. But the early stuff, it's just like, I know how he's making it, and it's not useful for me to copy it because that's a Banksy piece. I'm just doing a derivative work of his. But the sort of like technical artistry of it is something that someone else could do. And in the same for me, like someone else could do, if you have sufficient illustration skills, like a Finch piece. And it doesn't help your career to do that because everyone's gonna be like, oh yeah, you're just copying his style. But it's funny where it's like, well, you know, like what's like, is the magic just that I came up with this way of doing it? Like, is that what the art is? I don't know. It's sort of weird.
What is your answer for that? I mean, I want to get into your influences. And I'd say you're probably the best known street artist here in San Francisco. And it's, so I'm super excited for this entire conversation. And I want to talk about your influences, but I actually want to, I'd love for you to answer your own question there of where is the specialness of, I mean, I have my own, you're doing it. My own answer would be, well, you're actually doing it. But for someone like Banksy, at least pre 2010 to what you're saying, or for some of your work, you can say, oh, that looks simple. Like I have said, because I am a complete rube in so many museums of like, oh, I don't get it. That looks so simple. And I think it is, well, one, as you become a creator, you realize how much courage actually goes into just choose mm-hmm. that as your full-time. It's not this splatter of paint. It is a career of 30 years to get people to see that splatter of paint. But where is the actual magic sauce for an artist if you're saying that you could copy Banksy's work?
Yeah, so I don't know if there is any magic sauce. So people think about, oh, these artists are these special kind of magical people that do this kind of ineffable thing. But ultimately, when you take a step back, an artist is just typically a solopreneur who's running a little business where they have a product, which is their art, and they have sales channels, which are traditionally art galleries or coffee shops now.